Welcome to this RSET online session. I am Dr. Ringu Jacob from the Department of Basic Sciences and Humanities, Rajagiri School of Engineering and Technology. The topic of my lecture for today is nanotechnology. This topic is from second part of module 3 in the Engineering Physics syllabus for first year engineering students of circuit branch as per the KTU syllabus 2019. These are the topics I plan to discuss in this session. These are some of the questions taken from the previous university question paper related to the topic nanotechnology. So let us see what is nanoscience and nanotechnology. Nanoscience is the study of phenomena and manipulation of materials at atomic, molecular and macromolecular scales, where the properties differ significantly from those at large scale. Nanoscales are defined from about 100 nanometer down to the size of atoms, that is approximately 0.2 nanometers. And nanotechnology is the design, characterization, production and application of structures, devices and systems by controlled manipulation of size and shape at nanometer scale. That means in atomic or molecular or in macromolecular scale that produces structures, devices and systems with at least one superior characteristic property. The figure shows a comparison of the size and scale of RBC with that of a water molecule. The size of red blood cells are in the range of 7000 nanometers compared to a water molecule which is having a size in the range of nearly 0.3 nanometers. So the question is, why the nanoscale is so interesting for scientists and engineers? The reason is, at this scale, the properties of the materials that we see in large scale is very different in the nanoscale. One such property shown by materials in nanoscale is increased surface to volume ratio. Nanomaterials have a relatively larger surface area when compared to the same mass of the material produced in a larger form. This makes materials chemically more reactive and affect their strength or electrical properties. Some materials that are inert or not active in chemical reactions in their bulk or larger size are seen to be active when their size is reduced to nanoscale. In the figure, the bulk material is having more atoms inside it compared to the atoms on their surface. So it is less reactive in any chemical reaction. But when its size is reduced by breaking it, the atoms inside it will be coming out, and when we compare the surface area of each particles with their volume, then the surface to volume can be seen to be increased. When it is very finely powdered to nanoscales, then almost all atoms inside it will be out, and so the surface area compared to the volume of each particles is very high. That means as we reduce the size of the particles, the surface area increases, and when we reduce the size of the particles to nanoscale, it gains maximum surface area compared to the volume of individual particles. Now we prove that as we reduce the size of a material, its surface to volume ratio increases. For that, we take a simple cube as shown in the figure. We assume the entire cube is made of small cubes of same size like atoms in a material. So each small cube can be assumed to be as the basic unit cell. Let each side of this unit cell be one unit. So for the given large cube, length of one side is 3 unit. Now surface area of one face of the cube is length into breadth, that is 3 into 3 unit, which is 3 square. So the total surface area of the cube is surface area of one face multiplied by 6 faces of the cube, that is 3 square multiplied by 6, which gives 54 unit square. Now we calculate the volume of the cube of side 3 units, that is length multiplied by breadth multiplied by height. So 3 cube, which gives 27 unit cube. Now we check for the surface to volume ratio, that is 54 divided by 27, which is equal to 2. Now we reduce the size of the large cube by removing some of the unit cells, so that we get the cube as shown in the figure. Now we calculate the surface to volume ratio for this cube. So from the figure, the length of one side of the cube is 2 units. So the surface area of one face of the cube is 2 unit square. And total surface area of the cube is 2 square multiplied by 6, which gives 24 unit square. The volume of the cube is 2 cube, which equals 8. So the surface to volume ratio is 24 divided by 8, which gives 3. So as we reduce the size of the cube, we see the surface to volume ratio increases from 2 to 3. Now we again reduce the size of the cube by removing some more unit cells. So we get the basic unit cell as shown here. The length of one side of the cube is 1 unit. So the surface area of one face of the cube is 1 unit square. then total surface area of the cube equals 1 square multiplied by 6, which gives 6 unit square. Now volume of the cube equals 1 cube, that is equal to 1 unit cube. So the surface to volume ratio is equal to 6 by 1, which gives 6. So we can see that as we again reduce the size of the cube to that of a basic unit cell, the surface to volume ratio increases from 3 to 6. And this proves that as we reduce the size of any bulk material, the surface to volume ratio increases. Now we discuss the second reason why the nanoscale is so interesting. The reason is that quantum effects begin to dominate the behavior of matter at the nanoscale, particularly in the lower end, affecting the optical, electrical, and magnetic behavior of the materials. Before we further discuss more about the quantum effects, first we try to understand about a term called as quantum confinement. Quantum confinement is the restriction on the movement of atoms or molecules, which results in the change of electronic and optical properties of the materials when the material size is of sufficiently small, typically in the range of 10 nanometer or less. The quantum confinement can be observed once the diameter of a material is of the same magnitude as the de Broglie wavelength of the electron wave function. Now we see another term called as an exciton. An exciton is a quasi-particle, which means it is a bound or combined state of an electron and a hole, which are attracted to each other by the electrostatic Coulomb force. Exciton is an electrically neutral quasi-particle that exists in insulators, semiconductors, and in some liquids. It can transport energy without transporting net electric charge. The distance between an electron and a hole in an electron-hole pair, or exciton, is called as exciton Bohr radius. Now we classify the nanomaterials based on the dimensionality of quantum confinement or restriction. The table shows the structure of materials, the applied quantum confinement, and the number of free degree of movement, otherwise called as free dimension. In the case of bulk material or any large material where there is no quantum confinement, the particle has 3 degrees of freedom. So quantum confinement is 0 and the number of free dimension is 3, as it can move along x, y, and z axis in Cartesian coordinates. The quantum sheet or super lattice is having quantum confinement 1, which means it is restricted to move within a limited range of nanometers along one axis and no restriction along the other two axes. So the number of free dimension is 2. Quantum wire has 2 quantum confinement, which means the restriction is along two axes and free to move along one axis. So it is having 1 free dimension. But quantum dot have 3 quantum confinement, which means the quantum particle is restricted to move along all the 3 axes within nano range, and hence its degree of freedom is 0. Otherwise we say it is having free dimension as 0. First we take the case of quantum dots or nanomaterials of 0 dimensional structure. These are structures in nano range which are having the quantum confinement as 3. That means these particles are restricted to move within a range of 1 to 100 nanometers along the 3 axes, that is x, y, and z direction in Cartesian coordinates. So its degrees of freedom is 0. As an example, we consider a small sphere where all the 3 dimensions of this nanoparticle are restricted or confined within an exciton Bohr radius. Otherwise, it is called as zero dimensional potential well. An example for this structure is quantum dot. The figure shows an optical property shown by this zero dimensional structure, for example quantum dot. Here cadmium selenium quantum dots are taken in 5 different test tubes, and each test tube is having these quantum dots with varying size. Say 2 nanometer quantum dots in the first test tube, similarly 2.5 nanometers in the second, 3 nanometer in the third, 3.9 nanometers in the fourth, and 4.2 nanometers in the fifth test tube. Now when we shine the UV rays over the 5 test tubes, we see that even if the type of quantum dots taken in the 5 test tube is same, due to the difference in the size of the nanoparticles, quantum dot in each test tube emits light of different wavelength. But if you take cadmium selenium as a large size or in bulk material, it emits only a particular color. That means when we reduce the size of the materials to nanoscale range, we start seeing this type of optical properties that are not seen in bulk materials. The next structure is one-dimensional nanostructure. In these nanomaterials, one of the dimensions is limited or restricted to nanometer scale, and other 2 dimensions are free dimensions. So it is a one-dimensional potential well. An example for this is quantum wire or nanowire. Its diameter is in nanometers and length in micrometers. The figure shows the nanowires. The diameters are in the range of 3 to 20 nanometers and the length of the nanowire is in the range of 1 to 150 micrometers. The third type is two-dimensional nanostructures. These nanomaterials have two dimensions larger than 100 nanometers. As an example, consider a structure with height about exciton Bohr radius and the breadth and length are in micrometers. So it can be seen as a two-dimensional potential well. The example is a nanosheet. The figure shows the image of carbon nanosheets. We now discuss about the properties of nanomaterials. We first classify these properties into four categories. They are mechanical, magnetic, electrical, and optical properties. Now we look on to the mechanical properties. Nanomaterials have higher Young's modulus and its tensile strength is up to 4 times higher when compared to the conventional size or bulk size of the same material. It shows lower plastic deformation. It is more brittle compared to its bulk form. It is observed that strength and hardness of nanomaterials increases with decreasing size. This table shows a comparison of Young's modulus of nanoparticles and nanotubes with the conventional materials. It can be seen that iron is having a Young's modulus of 200 gigapascal, but the nanoparticles of iron having size of 100 nanometers shows a Young's modulus of 800 gigapascal, which is nearly 4 times higher compared to iron. And carbon nanotubes shows Young's modulus close to that of diamond. Now we discuss the magnetic properties of nanomaterials. The magnetic properties of nanomaterials depends on the synthesis method and chemical structure. Magnetic nanoparticles range from 1 to 100 nanometers in size and can display supermagnetism. These nanoparticles have zero coercivity, so they do not show hysteresis. An external magnetic field is able to magnetize the nanoparticles with much larger magnetic susceptibility. When the external field is removed, magnetic nanoparticles loses its magnetic behavior. Otherwise, we say it exhibits no magnetization. This property can be used for controlled therapy and targeted drug delivery. Liquid of nanoscale ferromagnetic particles, example magnetite, is used as a carrier fluid. It was invented in 1963 by NASA as an additive for liquid rocket fuel in order to move the fuel where there is no gravity to guide the flow. The figure shows the liquid of nanoscale ferromagnetic particles. When a magnet is placed under the container containing the liquid, due to the repulsion, the liquid is moving up and it can be seen as some pattern on the surface of the liquid. Now we discuss the electrical properties of nanomaterials. Electrical conductivity of a bulk or large material does not depend upon the dimensions like diameter, area of cross-section, twist in the conducting wire, etc. However, it is found that in the case of carbon nanotubes, conductivity changes with change in area of cross-section. It is also observed that conductivity changes with some shear force, that is twist, given to a nanotube. Conductivity of a multi-walled carbon nanotube is different compared to that of a single-walled carbon nanotube of same dimensions. The carbon nanotubes can act as a conductor or semiconductor in behavior, but bulk material of carbon, for example graphite, act as a good conductor of electricity. Now we see the optical properties of nanomaterials. Decreasing the size of material from its bulk state to the nano level, it increases the energy difference delta E between the allowed electron energy levels. So larger energy difference delta E means that the shorter the wavelength of the light emitted by the material. Otherwise we say it is blue shifted. So the color of the nanomaterials changed with respect to the size of the nanomaterials. As an example, bulk material of gold appears pale yellow color, but nanoparticles of the same gold appears red in color. The figure shows the color in which we see the silver and gold when they are taken as nanoparticles. Now to understand the reason why the separation between energy level increases when we reduce the size of the particles and confined to a limit of nano range, we have to take the case of particle trapped inside an infinite square well potential that we discussed in quantum mechanics. Here we assume a particle is trapped inside a potential well. Here the particle is allowed to move only along x-axis. The y-axis is the potential applied externally. The particle can move through x-axis if its kinetic energy is more compared to the potential energy it faces. So at the origin x equal to 0 and at a distance away from the origin, say at x equal to L, the potential is infinity. That means the particle can never cross or stay at x equal to 0 and at x equal to L due to infinite potential it faces. So the particle is trapped in between x equal to 0 and x equal to L. Otherwise, we say the particle is trapped in a potential well. Inside the well, that is the region between x equal to 0 and x equal to L, there is no restriction for the motion of the particle as the potential is 0. For such a trapped particle, the energy for its motion is quantized. That means it is not a free particle and it cannot move inside the well with any values of energy. It can move with only permitted energy or with a discrete energy. This is really what we see in the case of electrons inside the atoms. When the electrons are trapped inside an atom, its energy levels get discrete or quantized. So electrons are revolving in different orbitals which are having discrete energy, and we call it as permitted energy levels or orbitals. But once the electron is outside the atom, it can take any energy value. This is quantum mechanically proved. The discrete energy values that the trapped particle will possess is given by E is equal to n square pi square h cut square by 2m L square, where n is the quantum number, m is the mass of the particle, and L is the width of the potential well. Otherwise, in nanoscience, it is a quantum confinement range. The n is an integer that can take values 1, 2, 3, etc. Now, by using different values of quantum number n, say n equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, etc., we get a range of discrete energy possessed by the trapped particle inside the well. Now, if we plot an energy level diagram, we get the figure as shown here. Now we make a comparison of these energy levels as the size of the particle is increased. Let us assume a particle of size 1 nanometer that is trapped inside a square well of within nanometer scale. The energy levels of this particle is shown in the figure. Due to its small size, its mass will be very small. As per the discrete energy equation, when the mass is small, the separation between each energy levels E1, E2, E3, E4, etc. will be large. And if the mass of the particle increases, the separation between each energy level will decrease. So here, due to the smaller mass of the particle in the denominator of the equation, the separation between energy levels is large. Now let us increase the particle size to 3 nanometers. It can be seen that the separation between energy level decreases. As we again increase the particle size to 10 nanometers, the separation again decreases. Now we increase the size again to 100 nanometers. So the energy levels are very close to each other. And finally, when we take the case of a bulk material, say the size be 1 centimeter, then the energy levels are so close to each other and we see it to be as a band of energy levels. This happens because the energy levels due to a large number of smaller particles which constitute the bulk material will coincide each other. And this is normally we call to be as energy band. This energy band can be a valence or a conduction band in any materials. The figure shows how the separation between energy levels in valence and conduction band increases in a semiconductor material as the size of the material is reduced from bulk size to nanomaterial size. In the bulk material, the energy levels are so close that it is seen as a band of energy. But as we decrease the size of the particle, the separation between each energy levels in the valence and conduction band increases. Due to this, the band gap energy denoted by Eg, which is the spacing between the valence and conduction band, also increases. So if a transition from conduction to valence band occurs, the energy emitted will be more compared to that of the emitted energy due to the transition between conduction and valence band in bulk material. So we say that the frequency of the emitted photons will be more, otherwise it is blue shifted. From the figure, it is clear that as the size of the material decreases, the energy gap increases and the frequency of the emitted light increases. This is the reason why we see different colors in the quantum dots that we discussed earlier. It is clear from the figure, as we reduce the size of the particle from 4.2 nanometers to 2 nanometers, the light emitted is changing from orange, yellow, and finally to blue. This means as we reduce the size of the particles, then it is blue shifted. Now we discuss the other optical properties of nanomaterials. Absorption of solar radiation in photovoltaic cells is much higher in materials composed of nanoparticles compared to thin sheets made of the same material. That is, smaller the particles, the greater is the solar absorption. Silver nanoparticles are used to efficiently harvest light and for enhanced optical spectroscopies, including metal enhanced fluorescence, that is MEF, and surface enhanced Raman scattering, that is SCRS. Titanium dioxide nanoparticles have UV blocking properties compared to its bulk substitute. So it is used in the preparation of sunscreen lotions as it is completely photostable. Titanium dioxide nanoparticles will absorb or scatter UV rays but not the visible light, so there is less chalky appearance on the skin. Quantum dots can take energy of light and convert it into multiple colors. That is useful for many applications, Some of the applications are quantum.tvs and quantum.lighting. The figure shows the quantum.lighting. The quantum dots are used in TVs. Here the quantum dots are illuminated with blue LED backlight. Now we discuss the applications of nanomaterials. Nanomaterials are used to make tougher and harder cutting tools. Cutting tools made of nanocrystalline materials are much stronger, harder, wear resistant and erosion resistant and last longer. Tungsten carbide, tantalum carbide and titanium carbide are nanocrystalline carbides that are used in these micro drills. Ceramics are very hard, brittle and hard to machine, so they are difficult to use. However, with a reduction in grain size, these ceramics have increasingly been used. Nanocrystalline zirconia, a hard brittle ceramic, becomes super plastic. It can be deformed up to 300% of its original length. Silicon nitride and silicon carbide have been used in automotive applications as high strength springs, ball bearings and valve lifters. Next application of nanomaterials is for making low-cost flat panel electrochromic displays. Electrochromic devices are like LCDs. Nanocrystalline materials such as tungstic oxide gel are used in public billboards and stick boards to convey information. Electrochromic devices display information by changing color when a voltage is applied. When the polarity is reversed, the color is faded. The resolution, brightness and contrast of these devices greatly depend on the tungstic oxide gel grain size. Next application of nanomaterial is that it can be used as catalyst to react with harmful and toxic gases as carbon monoxide and nitrogen oxide in automobile catalytic converters and power generation equipment. This can avoid environmental pollution from burning petrol and coal. The magnets made of nanocrystalline yttrium samarium cobalt grains possesses very unusual magnetic properties due to their extremely large surface area. They are useful in quieter submarines, automobile alternators, land-based power generators and in magnetic resonance imaging, that is MRI, in medical diagnostics. Nanomaterials are also used in the production of sunscreen. Many sunscreens contain nanoparticles of zinc oxide or titanium oxide. Smaller particles are less visible, therefore, when the sunscreen is rubbed into the skin, it does not give whitish tinge. This is the end of this session. Thank you for watching this RSET online video session on the topic nanotechnology. For more lectures, please visit the link shown below.